Here we're going to talk about what's called the square root property and solving by completing the square. So let's start off with an example. Let's say we're asked to solve x squared is equal to 16. Well, can you think of two numbers that you square to get 16? Sure, right? X would be, well, positive 4 is one number, and another number would be negative 4. Now, a lot of times we write this in the following way just to save space. X is equal to positive or negative 4, okay? So there are really two solutions here, one for the positive and then one for the negative. So two solutions, positive and negative 4. Now over here, you're asked to square a number, right? Find a number that you square to get 2. Now you might say once again that, well, one of the numbers will be the square root of 2 because that's what the square root of 2 is. It's the number you square to get 2, the positive number you square to get 2. Now there's another number out there, and that would be negative square root of 2, because when you square that, you're going to get positive 2 as well. So for the same reasons, we write this as x equals positive or negative the square root of 2. And once again, we have two solutions. Now if you just looked, square root of 2. So if you just looked at the solutions from the original problem, look at what basically happened. You start off with something squared, isolated on the left-hand side, right, is equal to a real number. And the answer, well, in both cases, is x, in this case, is equal to positive or negative the square root of the right-hand side. And that's how it always is. Whenever you have a quantity squared, it doesn't have to just be x, but whenever you have something squared on the left-hand side, it's always equal to, the quantity is always equal to, plus or minus the square root of the right-hand side. Let's write that down. Here's the property we're going to be using. This is called the square root property. And it's that when you have x squared is equal to b, b can be any real number, you always get this. X is equal to plus or minus the square root of the right-hand side. Okay? So this is called the square root property. This is one of our main properties for what we're doing now. Okay, and it's called the square root property because it tells us how to deal with quadratics. You simply take plus or minus the square root of the right-hand side once you've isolated the quantity that's being squared. Okay, let's try another one like this. Okay, so for the first one, we're asked to solve x squared is equal to negative 3. Now, I said earlier the right-hand side can be any real number, including negative, right? So the square is the quantity squared is has been isolated on the left-hand side, and so we get x is equal to, well, it's going to be plus or minus the square root of the right-hand side, so plus or minus the square root of negative 3. So x is equal to, well, the square root of a negative, whenever you have a negative under the square root, that gives you I, so it's plus or minus I square root of 3, and these would be our two solutions. Positive I root 3 and negative I root 3. Okay, let's try this one. Now this one's a little different because the x squared has not yet been isolated, right? Or rather the quantity that's being squared. Let's first isolate the quantity being squared. And so we're gonna divide both sides by 2. And when we do that, we're gonna get, well, it's gonna be x squared is equal to 18. And now we can use the square root property. So x is equal to plus or minus the square root of 18. So x is equal to plus or minus the square root. Now 18 is 9 times 2. So x is equal to plus or minus, well, the square root of 9 is 3. So plus or minus 3 times the square root of 2. These would be our answers. Once again, we have two answers. Okay, now looking at this problem, this one's a little different because there is something being squared, but it's not just x. It's the quantity x plus 5. The same logic applies. You always want to isolate the whole quantity being squared. So I'm going to isolate this x plus 5 squared. And I'm going to do that first by dividing both sides by negative 2. And so the left-hand side is going to become, well, x plus 5 squared. The right-hand side is negative 20. Okay, that's the first step. Now we're going to use our square root property. And so the way it's going to work is we're going to have x plus 5 equals plus or minus the square root of negative 20. Do you see that? Whenever you have something squared, the next step is always to write that something no longer squared, equals plus or minus the square root of the right-hand side. Okay, now, two things have to happen. First of all, we have a negative under the square root, so that's going to give rise to I, but I also have to isolate the x, and I'm going to do that by subtracting phi from both sides. So let's do both of those steps now. So x is going to be, okay, negative 5, right? I subtracted phi from both sides, plus or minus I square root of 20. Okay, now the square root of 20 can be simplified. So it's negative 5 plus or minus I square root of 4 times 5. So x is equal to negative 5 plus or minus, and the square root of 4 is 2. So it's 2i square root of 5. So once again, I have two solutions. And those solutions are negative 5 plus 2i root 5 and negative 5 minus 2i root 5. Okay, let's try another one like that. Okay, so we're going to solve x squared plus 6x plus 13 is equal to 0. Now, I'm immediately stopped in my tracks on this problem because I noticed something much different about this problem compared to the previous problems, and it's this. Yeah, there's a quantity being squared, but there's also the same quantity only raised to the first power. Now, the problem is this. If you try to handle this problem the way we did the previous ones, and you isolate the x squared, the problem is that you'll still have the x on the right-hand side, and so you'll have x on both sides. And that is a no-no in mathematics, right? You want x on only one side. That's what it means to solve. X equals something. So our strategy from the previous problems isn't going to work. So we're going to first have to make use of what's called completing the square. Let me show you how to do that now. So completing the square. So what we're going to be doing is we're going to be creating perfect square trinomials. So just recall that if you have something like this, x squared plus 12x plus 36, remember that's a perfect square trinomial. That can be factored as x plus 6 quantity squared. And likewise, if you had something like x squared plus, let's say, 10x plus 25, that can be written as x plus 5 quantity squared. Now, what do these two have in common? Well, if you look at the middle term, here the 12, the middle coefficient, 12 divided by 2 is 6, and 36 is 6 squared. Likewise down here, 10 divided by 2 is 5, and 5 squared is 25. And that's always the pattern if you have a perfect square trinomial and the coefficient is a 1. The pattern is you take half of the middle coefficient. So for example, half of 14 is 7, and if you square 7 and you have a 49 here, right, what that means is that this can be written as x plus 7 quantity squared. Okay, so the same pattern applies in this situation. So what we're going to do is we're going to focus just on these first two terms, the x squared and the plus 6x. So to make our life easier, we're going to take the positive 13 and we're going to move it over to the other side. That is, we're going to subtract 13 from both sides. So we're going to get this. X squared plus 6x is equal to negative 13. We're just getting ready to complete the square. Okay, now, focusing on these two terms, as long as there's a 1 right here, which there is, what you do is you take the 6 and you divide it by 2, right? That was the pattern over here. You take these numbers and you divide them by 2, and then you square them to get the numbers here. So 6 divided by 2, that's the same thing as taking 1 half and multiplying it by 6. And we'll see why we're doing this in the next example. So 1 half times 6 is equal to 3, but then that's not it, right? You have to take that 3 and square it, and that gives 9. That's the number you want to add to both sides. So we get x squared plus 6x plus 9 is equal to 9 minus 13. Why did I do that? Why did I add 9 to both sides? Because now this left-hand side is a perfect square trinomial. Now, if you're not sure what it is, in this case, it's pretty clear that it's x plus 3 squared. But in the future, what you can always do and what you can always do is look at what you had here. Do you see how I took 3 and I squared it? That underlying number that you squared, in this case the 3, that always ends up being part of the perfect square. So this is going to be x plus 3 squared. In other words, you can always find the number that goes in parentheses right here by looking at what it was that you squared. Okay, that number always goes right there. Okay, and the right-hand side is 9 minus 13, which is negative 4. So now we're ready to use the square root property, and that's because I have something squared on the left-hand side, isolated. So I get, let's see, it's going to be x plus 3 equals plus or minus the square root of negative 4. So x plus 3 equals plus or minus, well, I square root of 4, and so I get x is equal to negative 3 plus or minus I square root of 4. I subtracted 3 from both sides, right? And then finally, x is equal to negative 3 plus or minus, and the square root of 4 is 2. So it's plus or minus 2i. And these would be my answers. And I have two of them, right? Negative 3 plus 2i and negative 3 minus 2i. Okay, let's try another example where we are solving by completing the square. Okay, so we want to solve this by completing the square. 2x squared minus 7x plus 2 is equal to 0. Now, do you see how there's not a 1 as the lead coefficient? You have to make sure that 1 is being multiplied by x squared to be able to do this. And so we're first going to divide both sides by 2. So the left-hand side becomes x squared minus 7 halves x plus 1 is equal to 0. That's the first step. Now we're going to subtract 1 from both sides to get these two terms by themselves. So x squared minus 7 halves x is equal to negative 1. Now we're going to complete a perfect square on the left-hand side just like before. Now what we have to do is we have to take the middle coefficient and divide by 2. That's kind of hard, dividing by 2. So I'm going to multiply by 1 half because it's a fraction. So I'm going to take 1 half and I'm going to multiply it by negative 7 halves. Okay, that's how it always goes. You take the middle coefficient and you multiply it by 1 half. In this case, I get, let's see, negative 7 fourths. Now that's not the number, right? That's not what we're going to add to both sides. You want to take that and square it. Okay, and when you square it, what do you get? Well, it's going to be 49 over 16. That's the number you want to add to both sides. Okay, let's do it. X squared minus 7 halves x. Okay, plus 49 over 16 equals 49 over 16 minus 1. Okay, now the left-hand side, the whole point of doing that is that now it's a perfect square, right? So it's going to be equal to what? Well, x. Now, do you remember how to get the number here? It's always the underlying number that's being squared. So that would be negative 7 fourths. So it's x minus 7 fourths, whole thing squared. And the right-hand side is going to be, well, let's see, 49 over 16, take away 16 over 16. So we're looking at x minus 7 fourths, quantity squared, is equal to, well, it's going to be 33 over 16. And now, the whole point of doing this is that now we can use the square root property. So we get x minus 7 fourths is equal to plus or minus the square root of 33 over 16. Okay, let's continue the problem now up here. So we get x is equal to, let's add 7 fourths to both sides. 7 fourths plus or minus, and let's break up this radical as well, right? So it'll be the square root of 33 over the square root of 16. And what's the square root of 16? That would be 4. So it's going to be 7 fourths plus or minus the square root of 33 over 4. And now that these have the same denominator, usually we write them as a single expression, or write this as a single expression. So we get x is equal to, okay, 7 plus or minus the square root of 33 all over 4. 7 plus or minus the square root of 33 all over 4. And these would be my two answers, right? Okay, so that's how we solve by completing the square. Now we're going to be solving, we're going to be completing the square generally, we're going to be solving by completing the square generally for quadratic equations, and we're going to find that that gives rise to a formula known as the quadratic formula. Okay, see you next time.